Good morning, everyone, and it's great to see everybody today. With us today, again, it's our pleasure, and we are grateful to have Dr. Larry Correll and Sue here to lead worship. We are truly blessed to have you here and welcome. Appreciate that. Our next announcement, Diane Shirk has a short announcement before we proceed.
Good morning. I just wanted to mention that the Walk for Life is going to be next Saturday. The mailing about it got lost by the post office to all the Freeport addresses, so that is a concern. And I know we just had a fundraiser for them in February from our congregation, and they're most appreciative of that. But if anybody would like to support the Walk for Life, I'll be walking. I have a pledge sheet and would be glad for any donations. The work they're doing is just amazing. Every week, it seems we have at least one pregnant mom who is abortion determined when she walks in, and when she walks out, she's chosen life. So we're seeing great results and hearts changed, and of course the gospel is shared with everyone who comes through the door. So thank you for the great support from the congregation, and if you'd like to add some to the Walk for Life, just see me, or you can text me or email me. I don't need any money ahead of time. Thanks.
Thank you, Diane. Now let's begin our service with the ringing of the bell and our prelude. Thank you. Now let us stand if we are able and sing to our Lord 262, Holy, Holy, Holy. And now if you would join me to the call to worship, and let's say this in unison. Father in heaven, how we love you. We lift your name in all the earth. May your kingdom be established in our praises, as your people declare your mighty works. And if you could pray with me. Father, thank you that you have brought each of us safely here to worship you in song and praise. As we gather, we remember those who are not with us today. For those who are sick, we ask for healing. For those away from us, we ask for your blessing to be on them. We invite your Holy Spirit to move freely among us. Come dwell in each of our hearts. Equip us, challenge us, comfort us, teach us, inspire us as we learn more about your ways. Father, as we meet now, may we behold your word and encounter your grace. We ask all this in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. Let's worship our God through one more song, Bless His Holy Name. And you can please be seated. Yes, LaVon is going to play that through one time because apparently Scott picked this out. And now it is my pleasure to welcome Larry once again.
Adam, are we on? We're good. Okay. Thank you. You've heard of have Bible will travel, or have gun will travel, have pulpit will travel as well. I told Scott when Scott and Sue were over at our house and the four of us were having dinner together, I said that I enjoy being here very much, but I wanted to be closer to you, especially today, when I'm wanting not to bring a theological message, an academic sermon, but I really want to share something that is very close to my heart, a passage of Scripture that is kind of like my personal testimony. And to do that, because it's so personal, I wanted to be in closer proximity to you. And if you saw me sitting here without a mask on, I hope I didn't offend you, but when Adam gave me the microphone, the ear microphone, between the microphone, the mask, and my glasses, I ended up, everything was upside down, and even the little thing down here on the end of the microphone popped off, and Adam had to put it back on. And to be perfectly honest, I was a mess. And so I left the mask off. I hope I didn't offend anybody, but I was facing that direction, okay? It's time for our morning prayer, and then followed by the Lord's Prayer. So let's bow in prayer together. Father, we are so thankful to be here today. In the midst of all of the changes that have come in our life in the last year, year and a half or so, and even though we have to do church a little bit differently than we are accustomed to, Lord, you've opened the doors of your churches and people come. And for those who can't come, you gave us the ingenuity and the creativity to begin broadcasting to live stream, to do all the things, some of the things we don't even understand what they are, but it gets the gospel out. And it allows us to be together, sometimes physically and sometimes over the airwaves. It allows us to be together worshiping our Lord Jesus Christ. And that's a brilliant thing. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for that. And thank you that we have been able to gather together in this particular service this morning. Lord, we come with hearts that sometimes are full of cheer and joy, and we're just anxious to talk to friends and neighbors and relatives and tell them about the good things that we have received from you in our lives. And sometimes we have struggled and maybe had some down periods during the week, and we need to share those things as well. And we're glad to be able to support one another and encourage one another, Lord. We remember that the Apostle Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians that you comfort us, and we are to comfort each other with the comfort that you give, with the encouragement that you provide. We need to beseech you. We need to supplicate for our friends and neighbors, for those in trouble, those hurting, those who are ill, those who are dealing with inexplicable problems in their lives for which they see no solutions. We pray for them in the name of Jesus Christ. And Father, you hear us, and you heal, and you solve problems, and you stop troubles, and you build us up and you lift us up, and for that we too are so grateful. We thank you for that as well. Father, we know that around the world, especially in the Middle East, that there is so much trouble. And we know that there is anger and hatred that has erupted into battles and attacks, not always with missiles or with weapons, but sometimes verbal attacks. And we know that those things spill over into every culture and every society, and we see that and we hear that here in America as well. Lord, we ask you to lift your sovereign hand over your creation, over people, and Lord, calm the storm. Lord Jesus, as you calmed the storm more than once on the Sea of Galilee, calm the storm in people's hearts today. And take away that angst and that anger and that hatred, and replace it with your love, your grace, your mercy toward one another, and your peace, the desire for peace. Father, as we continue to move through this service, as we open your word, we pray that you will enlighten our minds, soften our hearts, that we may not only listen, but we may truly hear inside of us. And the Lord, something that you bring, not something that a man brings, but something that you bring to us today in this service, will be life-changing, a different way to feel, a different way to think about you and about each other. So, Father, that's our prayer today. We love you, we worship you, we honor you, and we listen to you. And together we pray the prayer that our Lord Jesus taught us when he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. If you looked at your bulletin this morning, you know that the title of the sermon is God Bless You. I want to know how many of you have already said that this morning to somebody, or thought it? How many times during a week might we say that to somebody or write it? I don't know about you, but when I text with people or send an email to people, very often at the end of the text or the email, when I'm summing up and saying, you know, stay safe, be well, take care of yourself, and one of the last things I always write is, God bless you. And then you sign your name and whoosh, there it goes, right? What I'd like to do today, as I said, is to share something that's very personal to me, and something that, as this last year and a half has gone by, has become extremely important in my life. And it's kind of a testimony of what I'm feeling right now as a Christian believer. And God's just told me, when you have a chance, Larry, tell others, because what has helped me may help them as well. There is an old blessing in the Bible. In fact, it was given by God to Moses, and Moses told his brother Aaron, who was the first priest for the people of God, he said, when you want to bless people, bless them like this. And you could probably quote this with me without even looking at your Bible, but it comes from Numbers chapter 6, verses 22 through 26. And I'm going to read that very quickly to you, and then we'll talk about it for a little bit. The Lord said to Moses, tell Aaron and his sons, because Aaron's sons were also to act as priests, ministers to the people. Tell Aaron and his sons, this is how you are to bless the Israelites, the people of God. In our day and age, that includes us as well, the people of God, if we have a personal saving relationship with Jesus Christ. And here's what they were to say. Say to them, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. What God has been revealing to me and what I'd like to share with you is the significance of those simple words. And I'm going to do it. And now, don't be afraid. You know, usually preachers preach three-point sermons. I've got a seven-point sermon. But really, in that little blessing, there are seven words that I think are giant words. And we're just going to take a look at those seven words quickly together. The first word is this: bless. How often do we use that word? God bless you, I want to bless you, Jesus bless you, are you feeling blessed today? We're going to sing Count Your Blessings later in the service. We Christians use that word bless over and over and over again, and I don't know about you, but there are times when I hear a word so often that it loses its shape. Have you ever done that? You keep hearing a word, and pretty soon it kind of just loses its shape and loses its meaning. And I had to go back after being in a situation about a year ago where in a short period of time I heard the word bless over and over and over and over again, and I thought to myself, what does that really mean? Do you know what the word blessing means, or the word bless means? You belong. I traced the word blessing back through the English, back through the Latin, back through the Greek, all the way through the Hebrew, and even beyond Hebrew, which is the language of the Old Testament, back to some of the other ancient languages. And in every language, the word bless comes from a root idea that you belong. Let me read for you from a little passage in Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 and 15. For this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom his whole family in heaven and on earth derives its name. Do you have a name? Do you have a last name? There's nobody here that's just named Madonna. No, we all have a last name. What is the significance of our name? We belong to a family, right? And that family has carried that name for a long time. And that name signifies, in part, who we are and to whom we belong. And that's a blessing. To use our modern word, bless, that's a blessing to know that you are not alone in this world, but that you belong. You belong to a human family, and in Jesus Christ, you belong to the family of God. That's what Paul just said in Ephesians chapter 3. That God's family is blessed in heaven and on earth because they belong to him and have his name. That's what blessing is. To know that you belong to God. A human, little human story. Sue and I have a whole bunch of grandkids. Two of them, young men. One of them's a Black Hawk helicopter pilot for the Army and currently stationed in Romania, as our grandson Jake says, we're keeping an eye on Putin at our NATO base. But Jake belongs to us. He's part of our family. And then the other grandson lives in California and is stationed at Travis Air Force Base, and he's a flight engineer on one of those great big C-5 Super Galaxy planes. They call the plane Beans and Bullets because that's what they haul all over the world. And when those two boys were going off to their military lives, I wrote each one of them a letter, and I put it in their gear as they were taking off so that when they got to basic training, they would be able to find it and read it. And I reminded them, because both boys, when they were younger, had made professions of faith in Jesus Christ, and I reminded them that not only were they representing the United States Army, the United States Air Force, not only were they representing the United States of America, wherever they went and whatever they did, but I reminded them that they carried our family name. And so their integrity, their dignity, their honesty as young men would reflect upon us if they messed about. And then I reminded them both that they had at one time made commitments to Jesus Christ. So they also carried his name. They belonged. And wherever they were, they would know that they were not alone. They belonged to Sue and myself, to their parents, to our family, but they also belonged to God, not just the Army or the Air Force. When Moses told Aaron to bless the people of Israel, what God was saying through Moses and through Aaron was, tell the people they are not alone. They carry my name. Do you carry the name of God with you? Are you part of his family? The Lord bless you. And the second word is keep. The Lord keep you. It's one thing to belong, but there's another element of belonging, and that is to know that you will never be thrown away. How many of you have cleaned out a drawer, a closet, a garage? You knew you had too much junk, and you knew you better get rid of that junk. And so you know, whether you got out the dustbin or whether you pulled up a big truck, whatever you needed, you started cleaning and you started getting rid of the junk, the stuff that you just didn't need anymore, and you were going gung-ho and you're ready to purge, you know. And all of a sudden, whether it was something in the back of the drawer or something at the top of the closet or something in the garage that you hadn't seen for years, all of a sudden there it was. And you picked it up, whatever it was for you, you picked it up. And you knew you should throw it in the dustbin. But you looked at it. And you just couldn't give it away. Perhaps memories were attached to it. Perhaps whatever it was to you, it had something to do with who you are as a person. Whatever you were holding in your hand, it was so precious, it meant so much to you. It tied you to something good out of your past. You decided to do what? Keep it. You could throw out a lot of things, but that one thing you had to keep. Anybody ever do that? I got a whole drawer, closet, and garage full of things that I just had to keep. When God says, I will bless you and I will keep you, it's this incredible sense, this incredible feeling to know that my Lord says, I will never throw you out. I will never put you in the dustbin. I know who you are, and I know your shortcomings, and I know your mistakes, but I know your heart, and I know you by name. And I, your God, who created you and who loves you so much and wants you to live for eternity with me, I will never throw you out. I will keep you. What a tremendous thing that is. The Lord bless you and the Lord keep you. And then the next phrase, the Lord make his face to shine upon you. There's two words in there, face and shine. I've tried to study this little blessing and figure out why God used those particular words. What is the most personal, the most revealing thing you have? It's this. I can only see half of yours, but it's your face. I think the most revealing, most personal thing that God gave us was a face. Because really, when you look at another person's face, you can see who they are. You've seen faces that you hoped you'd never see again because they were so filled with anger and hatred, and you've seen faces that even though you knew the circumstances of that person's life and they may not have been very good, you saw a face that was full of love and gentleness and peace. You look at somebody's eyes. You see somebody smile, and it's been hard to see another person smile in this last year because of these things. But you know, God gave us this face. I can remember one time when Sue and I were in high school. We were high school sweethearts, and we were having a church supper, and they were missing something in the kitchen, and Sue said to me, "Would you run downtown?" This was in Mishawaka, Indiana, where we grew up. "Would you run downtown and get whatever it was? I don't know, bag of paper plates or something like that." So two of my buddies from high school and I decided to jump into our little Chevy Corvair. Remember those things? And we hightailed it downtown. Now the girls were back at the church preparing, and my two buddies and I are flying through Mishawaka. We go to the store, we get exactly what the girls needed in the church kitchen, and as we're getting back in the car, I was on the passenger side, and for some dumb reason, I jumped in, grabbed up here, swung my bottom in, sat down, and then proceeded to close the door on my own hand. And all I could see, you know, was from here, and then the fingers were going doom, doom, like this. And if you've ever slammed your hand in something, you know what I'm talking about, and the pain was excruciating. We were one block from the hospital. So the guy that was driving said, "I'll take you to the emergency room." So got the fingers out of the door, got to the emergency room, went in. They put me and my two buddies in one of those little cubicles in the emergency room, and the nurse said, "You sit up there on the examining table." And of course, I was holding my hand like this, and she closed the door saying, "The doctor will be with you in a minute." Well, between her closing the door and the doctor walking in, do you know what my friends did? They both jumped up on the examination table with me, and they held their hands. So there's three jerks sitting on an examination table in a hospital in Mishawaka, Indiana. The doctor walks in. He never looked at our hands. He simply looked at the three of us and walked right straight to me and grabbed my hand. And I said, "How did you know which one?" And he said, "Oh, all I have to do is look at your face." They didn't have pain in their eyes, but you did. God says the most revealing, most personal thing you have is the face that I gave you. But what does he say in this blessing? "I will turn my face toward you." See, God has a face. I don't know if it's a human face like we have, but God looks at us. And God reveals who he is to us. And in fact, a little bit later in Scripture, it actually says in Exodus chapter 33 that God spoke to Moses face to face. So when God says, "The Lord bless you, the Lord keep you, the Lord turn his face to you," what he is saying is, "You belong to me, I will not throw you out, and I want you to know who I am and how much I love you and care for you." And he makes his face to do what? What? To shine. He makes his face to shine upon you. Jesus tells us, Paul tells us, Peter tells us, John tells us in the New Testament over and over and over again that Jesus is the light of the world. And if you put your life with the life of Jesus Christ, you can walk in his light where there is no darkness. And in that little blessing in Numbers chapter 6, the Lord bless you, let you know you belong to him. The Lord keep you, won't throw you out. The Lord turns to you and reveals himself to you face to face. And then he says, what I want for you is a life of light. I want you to be able to see where you're going. And I don't want you stumbling around in spiritual darkness or intellectual darkness or emotional darkness. I love you. And that brings us to the next word. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you. And the Lord be what? Gracious to you. You know, the word grace is kind of like the word blessing. We use it all the time. And yet, have you ever stopped to think about what the word grace means? Now, there you've heard, and I'm sure over the years you've been in church, you've heard pastor after pastor, Sunday school after Sunday school teacher tell you what the theological meaning of grace is. God's unmerited favor that he shows upon you. There's all kinds of kind of highfalutin definitions of the word grace, but I have my own. I have my own definition, which I think fits here. The Lord blesses you, tells you you belong to him. He tells you that he wants to keep you and never throw you away. He turns his face toward you so you can know who he is. And he shines his light upon you. And then when you get to that word gracious or grace, do you know what I think it is? It's him saying to you, I really like you. I really love you. I know who you are. And guess what? I like you a lot. For a simple man like me, that's a simple definition of God's grace. That he says over and over again through hundreds of experiences that we have with him every day of our lives, that he really does not only love us, but he likes us too. Listen. Do you have somebody in your life, maybe a family member, maybe a friend, somebody at work, somebody in your social club, something like that? You love them, but you don't always like them. I got people like that in my life. You know, I got people in my own family. I love them because I'm the patriarch of the family now that my father is gone. I'm the oldest Correll living anywhere, I think. Probably not. But I love them. But I don't always like who they are, what they do, or what they believe. But when God says, I give you my grace, he is saying, I understand who you are. I know your deficiencies. I know the things that are wrong in your life. And I love you with an eternal love, a divine love. But I want you to know also that I like you. I made you. I know how you are knit together. And I like that. And I want to have a relationship with you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to express his grace, his love, and your likability. But there's two words left. That's only five. The two words left are this. Listen to this last bit. The Lord turn his face toward you. The Lord turn his face toward you. That word toward also means something to me. It just popped off the page about a year ago for me, and I'd read this so many times. And all of a sudden, it brought me back to Jesus. There was a point in time when Jesus was being whipped and being beaten and was ready to go to the cross. And you remember, one of his closest friends and allies is standing around an old burning pot in a courtyard trying to keep warm. You know who I'm talking about, the Apostle Peter. And Jesus is over here in this room being tortured, and Peter is over here trying to stay as close as he can, but filled with fear and anxieties and a sense of self-preservation. And three times people came up to Peter and said, "You know Jesus, don't you? You belong to Jesus, don't you?" And three times Peter said, "Oh, not me. I don't know who he is. I've never seen that man before." And somebody even said to him, "You're a Galilean." Do you know, if you were in Jerusalem and you lived in Jerusalem and you called somebody else a Galilean, do you know what that was like? That was like living in Chicago and calling somebody a hillbilly. Yeah. Galileans were considered kind of, you know, the old duffers of the ancient world. You could even tell a Galilean by the accent, kind of like that southern drawl. You could tell a Galilean by the way they dressed. They dressed differently than the urbanites around Jerusalem. And even when Peter was accosted and they said, "We can see that you're a Galilean, we can hear that you're a Galilean," he denied that he even knew Jesus. He denied where he was from. And there's a little verse, and I think it's in the Gospel of Luke, and it's easy to miss, but at that point in time it says that as Peter was denying Jesus for the third time, Jesus, in the midst of being beaten and whipped and denigrated, Jesus turned his face toward Peter. And I think made eye contact with him. And the Lord will turn his face toward you and look at you eye to eye, heart to heart. And he will say, "Whatever you're going through right now," just like he said to Peter. Remember, he had warned Peter this would happen. And Jesus did not turn his face toward Peter to say, "I told you so." He turned his face toward Peter to say, "I've got this. It's going to be okay. We'll work this out." And at the end of the Gospel of John, there's another time when Jesus turned his face toward Peter. Jesus has died on the cross. He's been buried, but he's also risen from the grave. Hallelujah. He's risen from the grave. And he meets Peter and some of the other disciples out on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, and he cooks them breakfast. John chapter 21, he cooks them breakfast. He's in his resurrection body, and he's got his sleeves rolled up, and he's cooking breakfast. And while they're sitting there, while the risen Christ and his disciples are sitting in the sand together, Jesus turns his face toward Peter. Remember, he had turned his face toward Peter when he was being whipped and beaten and Peter was denying him. And the second time he turns his face toward Peter, and this time he says, "So Peter, do you love me?" Oh, can you imagine what Peter must have felt? "My friend, do you love me?" And Peter said, "You know I love you. Then feed my sheep. Take care of the little ones around you. three times. Peter denied Jesus three times, and Jesus looked at him, turned his face toward him. Now Jesus turns his face toward Peter, and three times he restores him and says, remember, I told you we have this. We can take care of this. It'll be all right. And three times he turns his face toward Peter and says, do you love me? Then take care of my people. Take care of each other in the name of Christ. Wow. The Lord bless you and keep you, and the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And the Lord turn his face upon you. And what's the last word? Peace. What is this whole blessing in aid of? Why? What's the result of being blessed by God? It is that your heart would have peace. That your life would be peaceful. I'll end by telling you a story. One more story. It was a little mountain town that wanted to develop a tourist trade. So one of the things that they decided they would do would be to have an art contest. Amateurs could submit paintings. And then they would have a big festival on a weekend, and all the tourists would come and they'd see all the paintings. Well, this first year, the theme, if you were going to paint, your theme would be peace. And so a lot of amateur painters painted pictures, and they brought them to that little town, and the theme was peace. And they put them all out on the main street of this little mountain town, and people could walk up and down and look at them, including the judges would look at the paintings. And there was a painting of a beautiful mountain lake and clear blue skies, and there was a painting of a majestic mountain and little white, ruffly clouds in the sky, and it was gorgeous, and flowers and all the things that you and I associate with peace. But the last painting at the end of the street, somebody had painted a big canvas, and it was all black and it was all gray, and it was the picture of a lake, and the waves were gargantuan waves, and the water was boiling, and you could tell the wind was blowing, and it was the worst storm you had ever seen. And from the edge of the canvas, the artist had painted one small branch. And at the end of the branch, a fork. And in the fork, the artist had painted a small bird sitting in a bird's nest in the midst of a storm. Guess which painting won first prize? Because you see, peace is not the absence of war. Peace is security in the midst of the struggle. Peace is safety in the midst of the storm. That one artist understood that. What did God say to Moses, to tell Aaron, to tell you? The Lord bless you. You belong to him. The Lord keep you. He will not throw you out. The Lord make his face, the most personal thing that he has, to shine on you and take away the darkness. And to be gracious to you, to let you know how much he loves you and likes you. And it's a very personal thing for God to tell you that, because he turns his face toward you to speak to you and to give you safety and security, his safety, his security in the midst of the storm. Amen and amen. When I read that blessing, That's what I think about. And my hope and prayer in being here to preach this morning in this service was not the words that I spoke to you, but that God has spoken something about these words into your hearts. Something for you. And all of God's people said, amen. 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 I think that we are ready to close our service. Yes, we are. And you're going to see up on the board one of the great old gospel hymns, Count Your Blessings. Name them one by one. Count the ways in which you know that God loves you and shows that to you. So let's stand together and sing.
Thank you.
Let's bow in prayer together. Father, we thank you, bless you. Thank you for your word today. Thank you for Jim leading this morning. May we go knowing that we belong to you, that through faith in Jesus Christ, you will not throw us away, that you turn your face toward us, that you give us light, and you shed on us all of your grace and give us peace. May we go, Lord, with joy in our hearts today. For we pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. Go in peace.